So, Ross, Andrew Cuomo has certainly attracted a lot of attention in largely because of his press conferences, and I guess to some degree also the response to what's happening in New York, and it has been happening in New York in terms of the COVID-19 situation and the lack of facilities, the lack of equipment for to deal with this crisis. But we should say that I guess there are, you know, a lot of there's a lot of concern amongst, frankly, amongst progressives that this moment in time is not really representative of who Andrew Cuomo is. Let us just give us a little bit of a backstory, because the situation that we're in today is obviously, you know, Andrew Cuomo has nothing to do with COVID-19, but in terms of our preparedness for this, he does have some of his actions that he's taken in the past definitely have implicated the ability of New York State to respond.
Yes. So Andrew Cuomo, for those who are enamored with him, and I'm speaking particularly to people on the left, those who would self-identify as progressives, the issue with Andrew Cuomo is that as governor over the course of almost a decade now in New York State, he has not governed as a progressive. He has accomplishments like raising the minimum wage, getting marriage equality passed, and more recently some more progressive bills. But you know, for a long time, just talking politically, he kept the Republicans in control of the state Senate. He was very involved in ensuring a deep blue state like New York had a divided legislature. And then in terms of this crisis, he has been trying to cut Medicaid funding, and he was successful in the budget that just passed. Some of the cuts are going to be delayed so New York can get matching funds from the federal government. But Andrew Cuomo, someone who's not supported keeping hospitals open, he's presided over a decade of closures and over 2 decades, and this goes back to before Andrew Cuomo was governor, New York State has lost about 20,000 hospital beds. So he certainly isn't someone who has fought to keep hospitals open. There was a hospital in Brooklyn that actually Mayor Bill de Blasio hoped to keep open. This was really the centerpiece of his campaign, and Cuomo allowed it to close shortly after de Blasio took office. So, you know, he's someone who's really governed the state with an austerity mindset. He hasn't always been successful. That's the key. The state does spend a lot of money. Medicaid spending is still quite high in New York, but whenever he's gotten the chance, he's really tried to reduce spending, reduce certain services. And this is now the second time he has attempted to cut Medicaid reimbursements. And he's been very determined to do this, even in the midst of a horrible pandemic. When you cut Medicaid, simply, you're also cutting funding to hospitals, particularly public hospitals that are very reliant on this and are very poorly funded, relatively speaking, and run deficits. So Cuomo's cuts to hospitals are going to be really painful down the road. And this is something that some lawmakers in New York have raised alarm about already.
All right. Well, let's go back and let's take you know, break these things down. And we should say, just, you know, broadly speaking, when we're talking about cuts, there are options, right? One of them is to raise revenue. He has played around with property taxes as a way of giving the tax breaks to very wealthy individuals. He has also been instrumental in preventing legalized marijuana in New York State, and the estimates on what that could bring in terms of tax dollars is extraordinary. But let's go back a little bit. You said that Andrew Cuomo has been, in many respects, governing since day one as an austerity-minded, you know, I think in many respects, like one of these old, you know, moderate Republicans who is looking to defund the state in many respects. Well, just walk us through the IDC. I mean, when we say that this guy basically allowed control to Republicans to control the Senate, I mean, this was a a plan that he orchestrated to make sure that in one of the bluest states in the country, he would not get legislation that would be to the left of where he was, so that he could hide the fact that he was stopping it, essentially, right? Just tell us how he did that.
Yes. So this is going to be in the weeds a little bit, but it's actually quite fascinating, because for a long time, until the year 2019, New York State had a divided legislature. So New York itself is a Democratic state. The last time you voted for a Republican was Ronald Reagan in 1984. So that gives you an idea of where voters are. But for a long time, we've had a Republican state Senate due to gerrymandering, due to geographical disparities and sort of a traditional power in the suburbs and upstate. And this status quo was in the process of dying out. It was not sustainable in New York, given the registration numbers, to have a Republican state Senate long term. In 2008, Democrats took control. They did lose it in 2010 in the Tea Party year, and then Cuomo became governor shortly after that. So he did enter office with a Republican state Senate. The real crux of the story, this is where the sin comes in, and this is where I believe progressives and Democrats and those fawning over Andrew Cuomo really have to pay attention. The Democrats won control of the state Senate in 2012. That was the year, of course, Barack Obama won re-election. Turnout was high. Democrats were riding very high. And it was clear the era of Republican governance in New York was over. It just was not sustainable. It didn't make sense, just given the voter turnout, given who's voting. So Cuomo, instead of accepting that, allowed, sanctioned, and really encouraged behind the scenes this independent Democratic conference, a small group of breakaway Democrats. They'd formed their own third conference in 2011. They hovered there. You know, they had some interpersonal issues with the regular Dems. And he allowed them to form a coalition government with the state Senate Republicans. And it was this coalition government, which is unprecedented in New York state history, that froze the Democrats out of the state Senate. So basically what you had was a minority Republican faction with this IDC, and they co-governed the state together. And what this meant effectively was that progressive bills like strengthening laws to help tenants stay in their homes, to help renters in particular, criminal justice reforms, bills like the DREAM Act, which gave tuition assistance to undocumented immigrants, all these progressive measures were roadblocked in the state Senate. And the genius of this, if I'm going too in the weeds, you can stop me. The genius of this was that, as you said, if a progressive bill got blocked in the state legislature, Cuomo could throw up his hands and say, well, it's the Republicans in the state Senate. What can I do? I'm just the governor. They've got to send the bills to me. So it allowed him to play both sides. It allowed him to, on one hand, have this sort of centrist view of government really put into full effect, but it also allowed him to placate critics by offering this not really plausible explanation that he had nothing to do with it. And one other thing I just want to add very quickly, Cuomo also helped Republicans take control of the state Senate because he allowed them to gerrymander their own district lines in 2012. That's very important, too. The governor signs off on those lines. He initially said he wanted independent redistricting in New York. It was not independent. The Republican majority leader gerrymandered the state Senate. Hence, we had almost a decade of Republican rule after that point.
Yeah, I mean, it really is astonishing. And it was, it's sort of like the crisscross, right? I mean, this legislation gets killed and nobody, and I don't have my any blood on my hands is what Cuomo was doing. And then he also, we should say in that first term, there was people who know, I think largely, unless you really, really were in touch with what was going on in local politics, state politics in New York State, I don't even think a lot of the people who were represented by those IDC people knew what that meant. They saw the word, independent, Democrat. Oh, great. That sounds good. I like independent people. I like Democrats. And they didn't really fully understand what was going on. We had a situation with Cuomo where there was rampant corruption in Albany. And part of his campaign was to set up the Moreland Commission, which was a commission to look at it. And then when they got too close to corruption that was around him, he shut it down. Just to give folks a sense. I mean, this is just like a chapter of New York political history that people seem to forget. And so he orchestrated the death of all this progressive legislation, not unlike, frankly, Mitch McConnell, except for he got away without having to take responsibility for it. And then you had a challenge to him in 2014, I think it was, from Zephyr Teachout, basically calling to attention some of these things, particularly in that race, if I remember correctly. Cuomo's big push after Ken Langone, the owner of the billionaire owner of Home Depot, sat him down and said charters are the way to go. He had this big push to privatize education in the state. Zephyr Teachout called a lot of attention to that. And then we are brought up into like the year that we see people like the rise of AOC. And frankly, you had Cynthia Nixon. In my mind, what we can attribute to in terms of progressive moves from Andrew Cuomo is a function of him being afraid of Governor Nixon more than anything else. And she really drew a lot of attention to this IDC, and all those IDC people got voted out. So Andrew Cuomo has been stuck in this situation where he has not been able to count on the Republicans from quashing this progressive legislation and this progressive governance. And so now he's been in a bit of a jam, and he uses, in many respects, if you ask my opinion, because he's been trying to cut this Medicaid for a long time, he is using the cover of what is going on now with COVID-19 to push through that austerity budget where he cuts Medicaid. And again, we could have had a lot of billions of dollars worth of tax revenue with legalized pot in this state. You got people driving over to Massachusetts. You know, there's more New York license plates in Western Massachusetts trying to get pot there than anything else. It's ridiculous. And go through what the implications are of these cuts to Medicaid, because one of the problems that we have in this country is that, you know, we have 14 million people unemployed probably as of today. Maybe it's a little more. Maybe it's a little bit less. We're going to have more. And we don't know how we're going to give health insurance to the vast majority of these people.
So the worst implication of the Medicaid cuts is the loss of funding to hospitals, particularly the public hospitals. New York has a relatively low rate of people who are uninsured. We do a pretty good job of covering people, and that's in part why Medicaid spending has increased despite, you know, Cuomo's fighting to cut it. But the real tragedy is going to be when these public hospitals that are fighting coronavirus every day lose funding. These are hospitals that treat poor patients. So these aren't patients who come in with health insurance. They don't come in with those private plans with the big reimbursements. They come in with nothing, or they come in with Medicaid. So you've got this situation where the pain is really yet to come. These hospitals right now are in the fire. They are day in and day out in Brooklyn and Queens and the Bronx fighting to keep people alive. And these cuts, though they've been somewhat delayed due to the fact that federal matching funds for Medicaid wouldn't come to New York State if Cuomo kept his austerity plan in place. That's the irony of this. These cuts are still expected to come. So the great implication is the pain that will be caused in the hospital sector, particularly public hospitals. And I would add that you made a point before, which is very true. When you've got a shortfall, why not raise revenue? And I've been shouting about this for a while now. It's amazing that New York State is going to be billions of dollars in the hole because of coronavirus. We know that. And a normal governor, even someone who's not terribly progressive, would talk about raising taxes. You have to. You have to get revenue from somewhere, whether it's from marijuana, which Cuomo claims to support but has never really fought for, or from raising taxes on the wealthy. And New York still has a large number of millionaires and billionaires, or doing things creative like bringing back the stock transfer tax, taxing luxury homes. There's a lot you can do. And the amazing thing is Cuomo rammed this budget through, and there were no tax increases at all, and I made this point too before, that even Michael Bloomberg, the plutocrat of plutocrats, raised property taxes in New York City after September 11th because even he understood that you need to get money from somewhere, and when you have a crisis that blows up your budget, you don't want to just eviscerate your services. And my personal fear as a New Yorker is Cuomo is going to use this crisis to drive a severe austerity budget down the throats of New Yorkers. And I would add, it isn't just this budget. Cuomo has the power now, in part because the legislature and their complicity in this, to make rolling cuts to the budget throughout the year. So what seems like school aid right now, public school aid, I believe, was held flat. That can be cut, you know, in a few months from now. There are periods where he can just take a scalpel and just slice up all of these services. So that's a real fear. And for me, at least, as someone who studied the 1970s fiscal crisis in New York City, I worry that we are heading down that path where services are going to be severely reduced and you're going to have social unrest. And I hope we can avert that.
Lastly, Ross, why do you think he's doing this? I mean, look, it's a very blue state. He has, if he believed this stuff ideologically, he wouldn't have used the IDC as a fig leaf to achieve these goals. If he felt that's what the people in New York wanted, I mean, is it and yes, I suppose it could just be that this guy is so in league with the millionaires and billionaires in this state that he doesn't want to tax them just because he is of that ilk. But I imagine that there's more to it.
I as someone who's covered Cuomo now for almost since the beginning of his tenure, it's hard to say. At his core, Cuomo is a corporatist and a capitalist, and he is someone who will do progressive things, but he'll only do them if he's dragged there. He won't raise the minimum wage unless you build a campaign for years and years, and he reluctantly does it when he decides it's good politics. So his politics fundamentally aren't of the left. He comes from the Clintonian third way mindset, that this is something I've just come to believe watching him. And now he really has the cover to do a lot of this stuff. And that's really the fear that progressives should have. And this is something that people should be a lot more aware of, because his poll numbers have gone way up due to COVID-19. He now is going to be able to pursue the kind of budget he'd always wanted to pursue, which really are those bare bones budgets. You know, like I said, you look at Cuomo's record as governor, there are real progressive accomplishments, but these usually come despite what he really wanted to do. They come from public pressure, from labor unions, from the Democratic State Senate, which finally took office in 2019 and really pushed a lot of this stuff through. So now you have this situation where we are in a wartime crisis, and there is very little scrutiny of what Andrew Cuomo is doing, and he has the cover of high poll numbers where a lot of legislators are afraid of him. They were always afraid of him, but when Andrew Cuomo had an approval rating of 40% or lower, which is what he was running for a long time, you could buck him. Now he's at 70%+, and he's a national media darling. So he's got really a lot of political capital to do a lot of damage. And this is something that I hope voters, Democrats, progressives, those who pay attention, really wake up to in these next few months.
Well, Ross Barkin, writing in The Nation, thanks so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.